Nice to virtually meet everyone. But without further ado, maybe we could pass on the stage, probably to Cap, to tell us more about the delegation system for Capital DAO.
Sure, guys. Yeah, thanks for having us out. Welcome to everyone here. We're pretty excited both about crypto unicorns in general. Stoked to be in the unicorn fam. And I'm happy to, you know, explain a little bit about how the tech here works, because it gets pretty complex pretty quick. And we want to make sure that everyone is, you know, on the same page and understands exactly how, miraculous some of the stuff is that we've managed to achieve. So I guess, real brief, folks, there are two very, very important components of the Capital DAO delegation system that should be really interesting to each one of you. So first is that, you know, the system doesn't actually require the games themselves to spend any development time on the integration, right? So that means that games can just stick to, you know, making great content, fantastic user experiences, memorable stories, and they can, you know, kind of leave the delegation component over to us. And that's because we're what we call a post-production solution. So that means that you can add this, the Capital delegation solution, to games after they're already deployed without the games needing to change any of their code. And so that's a pretty big advantage, you know, when, you know, we're considering that we want games nowadays to be trying to build these fantastic Web3 experiences with these really brilliant environments, and we just want the best gameplay possible. So we're, you know, generally happy to partner with a ton of games so that we can provide that level of engineering support to them while they focus on, you know, making content that's truly great. And, you know, we have a list of over 50 other games who are all thinking in exactly the same way, because they want to focus on pushing out really, really great content and, you know, driving gameplay to their players where they need to. Then a second pretty major point here. So we are not just ordinary delegation. So we call our setup hierarchical delegation, and there's a pretty big difference. So with traditional delegation, that's what you guys may be used to. It's where one person rents an item or delegates an item to exactly one other person. And that's not particularly scalable, right? That's it's not useful in an organizational capacity, because then you have to have every manager own every asset in order to then delegate it to a player. So instead, you know, our solution here, what we've built, is you can basically see it as a real organizational scaling tool. No matter how many assets or managers you have, you can essentially take one asset at the top owned by an admin, and then you can delegate it to a manager who sub-delegates it to a player, on and on down a chain. And it's that level of organization that we see Web3 gaming moving towards, where we estimate, you know, as we speak with some of the top 10 esports teams across the world, you know, as we engage them and we see that the direction that this whole space is moving is really towards massive institutional scale in gaming. And that's what we've, you know, kind of built the solution to handle. And so you should, you know, imagine it kind of in the context of, we call it admins, managers, and players. So an admin is kind of like the CEO of a guild, and they own all the assets, and then they can delegate those assets to managers, who can then sub-delegate those assets to players. So it's a pretty big paradigm shift from the ordinary, you know, rental contracts that you guys may be used to. And the reason is because we're trying to bring in that massive institutional scale capital into these games and enable people to deploy millions of dollars quickly into these environments, you know, at scale. And so we're pretty stoked to be bringing it into the Unicorn fam, and we're happy to take more questions here and explore.
All right, so now while we're waiting for Aaron to come in, Cap, or Sam rather, there are questions coming your way, so I hope you're ready to take them in. But the first one, without further ado, this is a question for you again, Sam. Will Capital DAO work if my guild members are on Facebook and not Discord?
Yeah, great question. So right now, only Discord is enabled. We will be in the future looking at other OAuth solutions, is what they're called, you know, one-click logins. And in that case, we may be able to enable Facebook as well. But today, the focus is still on Discord.
All right, next question again for Sam. Can I use Capital DAO with hardware wallets?
So that's a great question. We actually recommend that guilds use a blend of hardware and hot wallets. For, you know, clarity in the audience so that everyone understands what we're talking about, a hardware wallet, also called cold custody or a cold wallet, that's where you have, you know, basically like a USB type drive, and your keys are stored on there. So your assets are stored on there. A hot wallet is like MetaMask, where it's stored in your browser and you can use it pretty easily. So what we recommend is that guilds use hot wallets for, you know, managers and players, because they need to be executing a ton of transactions. There are just a load of transactions, and it's not scalable to sit there and press accept on every single one on a hardware wallet. But we do recommend that guilds use hardware wallets, you know, to store the assets ultimately. So basically you would, you know, play the games and generate the assets using the hot wallets, which are your MetaMask, et cetera. But then at the end, you should be moving them, and you can move them inside of the framework over into hardware wallets.
Awesome. Thanks for that, Sam. That were just a few questions to start off, but I've definitely learned a lot from that conversation already. How about you, partner?
Yeah, I learned already the ropes of this delegation system, and definitely I'm looking forward to hearing more when Aaron arrives. But even with this extensive discussion, I'm sure there are lingering thoughts that are need to be asked for tonight.
That's right. So with that, we are now welcoming questions for our audience here tonight. But first, quickly, a few reminders for you guys. We are only accommodating 2 questions per audience member, and you have the option of whether to come up on stage and ask the question yourself, or let us, the host, ask your questions by sending them in on our text channel allotted for this event.
That's right. We will simultaneously ask questions to those going on stage and to those who sent their questions.
Right. And before we officially open the floor, we would also like to share the document in the text channel with the list of questions that Capital DAO and Crypto Unicorns have already answered. And perhaps you guys can use that document as a reference for all of your questions.
That's right. Again, we highly, highly encourage that you consult that document too, because questions that are repeatedly asked will be skipped to maximize and cater to more questions.
Right. It's 9:15 on the clock. We have the rest of the hour until 10 p.m. on our time to accommodate all of your questions. You may now start raising your hands and sending in your questions.
Maybe to keep the ball rolling, I would just like to ask a question that was also sent here in our chat. Maybe Sam can also answer this for us, given that this is a partnership indeed with Crypto Unicorns. Are there any marketing activities that are planned ahead for our guilds or probably our scholars out there?
We certainly have a number of marketing activities planned on the Capital DAO side coming up here. And I would actually advise everyone to stay tuned and watch our website, maybe sign up on the mailing list, because we're going to have a relatively big announcement regarding a token potentially at some point in the near future. But from the Crypto Unicorn side, let's wait for Aaron and the other gang to answer that one. But I'm sure that they have all kinds of fun stuff lined up for you folks.
Following on that question, maybe Cap can also, or Sam rather, can also share with us what sparked the partnership between Crypto Unicorns and Capital DAO.
Sure. Yeah. So the relationship that we've set up here is that the Capital DAO is providing one option for a delegation solution within the Crypto Unicorns community. And so what that entails is that anyone who wants to opt into it can use the Capital DAO delegation solution to essentially house their assets in a way where they can delegate them to managers who can then sub-delegate those assets to other players. And again, the kind of point that we keep running back to is we're working with the world's largest guilds actually actively to deploy the system for them, just because this idea of hierarchical delegation within these corporate structures is so, so important to games.
All right, thank you so much for that, Cap. We're waiting on several questions right now, but definitely so far I'm learning a lot. How about you, Claire?
Same as well with you, Kat. If you guys have any questions, don't hesitate to ask them. Just use the raise hand feature here on the stage and you can ask them yourselves. But if you're a little bit shy in asking your questions, you can send them in on our AMA text question thread. So don't worry about that. We're looking forward to hearing from you guys.
All right. So for this one, this is a question also from our audience. Do we have an option to ban users in your platform? It's also kind of a suggestion that the person can be blacklisted when an admin or manager bans them so that other managers from the same platform can be warned when a certain user was malicious. Oh, this is very interesting. Sam, take it away.
Yeah, Kaiser, thanks for asking that. You know, it's something that we're trying to build out right now because obviously we want to be very sensitive to guild data, right? And so guild user data belongs to the guilds and we don't want to expose any user data that the guild doesn't want to expose. But we're working on an option whereby guilds can publicly flag themselves so that they can share data with other guilds and essentially say, yes, you know, this user was malicious. This is, you know, a bad actor. We should ban them cross-platform. That is something that we are actively looking at doing.
Awesome. Thanks for that, Sam. Next question for you would be, can you tell us more about the project's technical roadmap and key features that the team is currently developing?
Sure. Yeah. So guys, we build very fundamental gaming asset management tech is how I would say it. So the biggest key feature that we're building out is our delegation solution, essentially, which does enable each one of these admins to delegate to managers, to delegate to players. But the key value add here is that it's all wrapped into one common UI with common accounting standards, common code standards, et cetera, which are sorely lacking in the place. So the next big technical development that you're going to see come out is we're actually going to roll out an SDK, a software development kit, that's going to enable games to add essentially our functions to their games without us needing to do anything at all. And so at that point, we expect, you know, the 50 plus gaming partners that we've already signed to then start onboarding into the platform on their own. And at that point, you know, you can imagine scholarships will be enabled in games that, frankly, you'd never considered should even have scholarships before. And so it's that kind of level of scale and capital in the space that we're really trying to drive it towards together. And the tech that we've built here is honestly the first step towards doing that from an institutional standpoint. Even beyond that, we are addressing additional technical, I would call them, you know, premium features, essentially. So these would be things like you're allowed to deploy an entire guild plus token in as little as 10 minutes. And so anyone who's already operating assets and they're already a manager, they can simply go into our UI, click a couple buttons, and they have already deployed a full token with a full token treasury, you know, an accounting system, as well as voting, staking, et cetera, all wrapped into one neat UI. And so what we expect is that, you know, everyone right now who doesn't, frankly, have, you know, the engineering resources to build up a token or a guild themselves, they'll be able to not only manage all of their gaming assets at scale, but then they'll also be able to take those same assets and turn that into a guild immediately. And so we hope, you know, that we're going to drive a large number of even smaller users to start building their own guilds as well.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Cap. We also have another question coming up from the text channel. What's a gaming DAO, and is the rewards a zero-sum game?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, a gaming DAO encompasses a large number of different things. We see some gaming DAOs, like our, you know, friends over at YGG or Merit Circle, who, you know, essentially make these capital allocations to seed term investments, as well as operate some number of scholars in the space. We see some other gaming DAOs that are starting to come up that are frankly more like esports teams than anything else, and they're just really trying to attract and retain talent, have talented content creators, etc. But those are all different types of gaming DAOs. I think part of your question here around is it zero sum, you know, that's really on the game side. You know, is the game a zero sum game? And we're actually seeing more and more of those come out. You know, without naming any too explicitly here, there's actually a couple of shooters that I can think of that are already trying to deploy sort of zero-sum game loops. Shrapnel is one of those, actually. And so it's zero-sum game loops, sustainable token economies, and partial fractional ownership to the actual users. Those are all things that I would kind of include under that umbrella of gaming DAOs. And those are, you know, those are factions that we are actively partnering with even now as we keep trying to fold more and more of them onto the platform.
Glad to hear we're working on partnerships for gaming DAOs. Another follow-up question for you, Sam, from Jackie Ace here. Your target customers are institutional investors, not smaller scale managers, right?
Yeah, Jackie, that's a great question. And thanks for all your other questions over in the Crypto Unicorns chat. I do really appreciate you guys digging in. Right. So the delegation solution, honestly, it's built for institutions, right? So that means that we have an eye towards things like accounting standards, you know, certain institutional compliance standards, rigorous audits, etc. But the way that we've deployed the solution means that anyone, even if you only have 10 scholars, can still very easily spin it up and use it. And kind of the purpose there is that we hope that this will enable individuals who are maybe not so, you know, well-versed in gaming, people who don't understand how to play Crypto Unicorns themselves, for example. It will enable them to buy, you know, $10,000, $20,000 worth of assets and then delegate those to a manager, say someone in the community who does understand how to play Unicorns. And then that manager can then turn delegate access to those assets to players. And so what we're hoping will happen here is that not only do we usher in, you know, kind of a grander vision around bringing in institutional capital into Web3 gaming at scale, but we're also looking to enable, you know, individuals of all shapes and sizes, regardless of their level of comfort within gaming, to effectively participate and run a guild without actually having to run it themselves, thanks to hierarchical delegation.
All right, thank you so much for that very, very extensive answer we have right here. But following that, I guess Jackie Ace right now is very inquisitive. Your target customers are institutional investors, not, okay, that was answered already. Rather, what's your take on the risks involved using your delegation tool? And what happens if there is a security breach with loss of assets?
Yeah, Jackie, it's a great series of questions. So first and foremost, guys, no one should ever promise you that anything is 100% safe. If they are, you should probably turn the other way because they're not telling you the whole truth. So the truth of our tool is that it operates inside of Amazon Web Services secret key storage nodes, right? And what that effectively means is that your assets are as safe as your Amazon Web Services account and the associated programming that goes into those nodes. So those nodes, we're eventually going to open source the code for that, and you folks can actually see it on your user side. And you can validate that code, so you can make sure that you're comfortable with the, you know, the level of access that the code has. And beyond that, we've also retained the number one audit security shop in the world for Web3, actually, Halborn, to help us, you know, ensure on an ongoing basis that our code is robust, right? And so what they're doing effectively, so that you guys understand what that entails, in cybersecurity, there are two different divisions that generally deal with the code base. There's the blue team, which is basically an ongoing monitoring force. And they're basically watching for intruders who may have popped in, you know, things that may have been exposed or fallen out of place. And then there's also a red team. And the red team, those are kind of the hackers in the hoodies, and they're hiding behind their laptops and they're trying to break your system actively. And so what we've done is we've gone ahead and retained both a blue team and a red team. So we have a team of hackers that is consistently trying to break the system day in and day out. And so we hope that that gives you, you know, some amount of peace in that we have, you know, a team of insiders who's actively trying to exploit the system. And, you know, to date, nothing has been found. But we'll work with them in lockstep to resolve any issues that come up along the way.
Thanks for that very reassuring answer, Sam. Keep the questions rolling in, you guys. Again, you can ask your questions personally by using the raise hand button here on our community stage and ask your questions yourself. And if you're too shy to ask your questions, our AMA questions text channel is very open for any questions that you might have, and we will gladly read them out for you. Great. So here, it's a question again from Jackie Ace. A follow-up question to the previous answer. Yeah, but what's actually going to happen when there is a security breach? Is there any insurance/liability from your side?
Yeah, Jackie, that's a good question. So we are not a custodian. To set a quick definition here, a custodian is someone who holds your assets. That means that because we are not a custodian, we're not liable for the loss of assets if they happen to disappear, because you're holding the assets in your accounts on code that you can see. Having said that, we actually are already in talks with certain insurance groups within DeFi who do insure items like this. I wouldn't say that those talks are advanced, though, but it is something that we're looking into just to provide you that extra cushion.
All right, so we're expecting a lot of people or questions rather coming in. But for now, you know what, Claire, this is really something that I'm looking forward to, and right on cue, we have someone here requesting to speak. So Kaiser, take it away, please.
Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Awesome. Hey. Good evening or good time zone. I just have two questions. The first question is, is the delegation system free for us to use, or is it a subscribed service? Or is it a free service with a premium features as subscribed service? Or how is this system going to work for us?
Yeah, great question, Kaiser. So right now it's completely free. All of it is 100% free. And to be completely transparent, I believe that you will pay something like $15 a month, not to us, but to Amazon Web Services for your account over there. And so you should expect, you know, at least for the near term, for the service to be absolutely free. What we will be doing in the future, and this is, you know, to entirely support the operations of the Capital DAO itself, is we will turn on a 1% fee switch, which will essentially take 1% of cash out transactions that move through those ecosystems. In addition, we're also going to offer some additional services, but they won't be, you know, they won't be natively tied to the actual guild management. They'll be, you know, ancillary services like deploy a token, you know, other certain promotional bits, but nothing related to the actual guild management. You should expect that to only ever have a 1% transaction fee, which will be turned on, you know, sometime down the road, but not now.
Awesome. Thank you for that answer. My last question would be, any features you are interested for us users to use that you can reveal in this AMA? Since Aaron is not here, maybe we can share some little alpha.
Yeah, sure. Here. This is going to be a neat one. This will be fun for you guys. And this is a very complex problem, so I don't want to overpromise, but we are exploring some very interesting things around the ways that scholars interact with NFTs. Something that you guys may be noticing in games is that the idea around play to earn, as it was originally conceptualized, rotates around tokens. But now more and more games are becoming complex, right? You have tokens, you have NFTs, there's a mess of different things that can accrue value. And no other system in the space, first of all, is even close to our level of hierarchical delegation, but no one else is even thinking about how scholars are going to be able to monetize NFTs. And we actually do have a set of solutions that we're starting to develop and hopefully we'll be rolling out sooner rather than later. Around basically enabling scholars, for example, in Axie, to do things like make runes and then potentially sell runes back to the guild so that they can monetize that. And in that way, you know, it's really trying to drive towards players having complete autonomy to perform inside of the game, but then they're incentivized to perform the best actions inside of the game because the only way that a scholar can cash out is by going through the guild because the account is owned by the guild. And so those are the kind of really interesting engineering loops that we're diving into and trying to figure out so that as Web3 gaming continues to evolve, we stay one step ahead of the curve. And you guys as managers and admins and even players, you know, you can have this seamless Web3 experience where you can manage your assets, cash out, etc., and all of it just works.
Awesome. That's a lot of features. I appreciate it. Well, that's all my questions for now. Thank you so much, Ubu.
Thank you so much, Kaiser. Definitely. I hope you've learned a lot from that question. Following up on another question that we have here, where do we see the guilds in the future now that the P2Es are not in a good place?
Oh, yeah, that's a big question. So everyone's asking that, you know, both internally and on external investor circuits. What I can tell you, folks, is that guilds are not going anywhere. You know, a lot of us probably grew up playing World of Warcraft and EVE and all these other major games with massive community presences, and a lot of them which did have some semblance of real assets. Maybe they were traded on gray markets, maybe they weren't expressly acknowledged inside of the end user license agreement, but guilds managing assets and players at scale is neither new nor going away. So what I expect to happen is that over the next couple of years, we're likely to see something like a migration towards real esports type character in guilds, and then those are also the types of games that will have the highest reward base. And so you'll see really talented players probably paired, frankly, with less talented players who are just collecting resources like you would in RuneScape or Albion or anything else. And those two will kind of live in harmony. So, you know, major guilds are not going anywhere. They will not disappear. The only thing that you're going to see is that games will start to shift, and then guild models will shift accordingly to match that type of system. I've actually written a little bit about this before. If you guys go visit my Medium, I call this a gladiators and lumberjacks dichotomy. And it basically amounts to a situation where you have players who want to opt out of risky situations. And I call those lumberjacks. They're people who want to collect resources, get paid for collecting resources, but not taking risk. And then you'll have gladiators. And those are people who want to post risk because they want higher reward. And so, you know, they're people who in EVE, for example, would fly a giant spaceship into a big battle because they think they can blow up the other guy and take his stuff. And so you're going to see that dichotomy start to emerge across Web3 gaming, and guilds will start to, you know, kind of migrate into a pattern that matches that, is where I see this going.
Thanks for that, Sam. I believe we've skipped a question here on the text channel from Jackie Ace. They ask, from a messaging perspective, it's great to have insurance on this, especially when small-scale managers without any knowledge on what they're setting up come in. Cash out equals stash out? Is that your question, Jack?
Yeah, Jackie, good questions here. We, you know, insurance in DeFi is a concern for everyone across the entire crypto space. The reason it's obviously so important is because what we're dealing with are proper physical electronic assets, which is quite an oxymoron if you think about it. But when you have something in your MetaMask, I mean, you actually own it. So if someone steals it, it's gone. It's not like your credit card where, you know, you can call up the bank and tell them you didn't mean to make the transaction. It's really, really gone. So it's a problem that's actively being solved across the space. And I believe actually over out of our Hivemind fund, we did make some investments in certain insurance protocols that are actively looking to solve this. And it's a space that I'm frankly quite interested in. So I would expect us over time to try to offer something like that in a core partnership. And then cash out equals stash out. Yeah, that's right, Jackie. So I believe Crypto Unicorn's terminology there is stash out. For us, the way that it works inside of the app is that you should imagine anything that sits inside of the wallet that operates the account, that stays in the wallet and in the account, and the player can use that to optimize their performance inside the game however they want. But then they have to go into the app, so the Capital app, they have to go in there and they have to press cash out, which removes cash from that wallet, moves it into the admin's guild vault, and pays out the scholar whatever percent the scholar deserves. Does that make sense?
All Well, I hope that answered your question, Jackie. We also have a following question over here. What are some of your plans to stay active and provide projects and opportunities to the community in the long run? And what's your roadmap? Do you have interesting news for us? This is definitely something we're looking forward to, Sam. Take it away.
Yeah, I mean, we are we're quite excited to keep building out both larger partnerships within Crypto Unicorns as well as other partnerships with other games. And frankly, we kind of see this as a blue ocean situation where all of the games can come together, you know, all of the guilds can come together. There's still enough space for multiple winners. And so we're really just looking to support, you know, anyone in the space, both guild and game, who's really trying to bring institutional scale and massive amounts of capital back into the space so that we can see, you know, a bigger run up just like we saw before as Web3 gaming really takes off.
Thanks so much, everyone, and for all of your questions, and also to Sam for accommodating them and for giving us such great answers. But I know this is a Crypto Unicorns X Capital DAO event, but we just received news that Aaron can't make it to this AMA due to emergency reasons. So any questions directed towards Crypto Unicorns will be answered on tomorrow's Crypto Unicorns Town Hall number 14. So make sure you guys head on over to discord.gg/CryptoUnicorns to get the latest information on the Crypto Unicorns Town Hall. Thanks, you guys.
Well, what can I say, partner? All good things must come to an end, but we're definitely not ending on a sad note because we've learned a lot from Sam about what's in store for us. And for sure, everybody joining us tonight is also excited to play this one-of-a-kind game. Guilds, for sure, are conceptualizing already how to effectively invest their time and efforts in crypto unicorns.
That's right, Kat. But before we wrap up this event, we're giving you guys a couple of minutes to ask questions. If you guys still have, again, you can ask questions using the raise hand button or send them in through our text channel at the AMA questions text channel. If not, we can go on overhead and wrap it.
So yes, we're taking this opportunity for you guys to ask in your last minute questions that are probably still lingering in your thoughts. This is your chance to follow them up while we still have some Sam over here.
That's right. It's only a few opportunities where you can actually get real-time answers for your questions, right? Okay, I think we have one more question coming in.
Okay, while we're waiting for her again, this is to repeat that we are accommodating last minute questions for Sam over here. It's a one-of-a-kind opportunity for him to be joining us tonight, so you might want to maximize this opportunity. But so far, you know what, Claire, based on the answers of Sam over here and based on the questions, I'm definitely looking forward to playing Crypto Unicorns myself. I've seen the website, I've seen the page, and it looks like a treat for all of us, definitely. What are your thoughts on it?
Definitely. Imagine if I shared Crypto Unicorns to someone who doesn't really know anything about crypto. I think they'll be... Yeah, excited as I am to play the game as well, because it looks so cool from the trailer. Okay, there we have questions on our text channel from Jackie. One last question to clarify on the cash out. So in CU, we have the in-game wallet and the on-chain wallet. The funds on the in-game wallet are used for in-game stuff. The funds on the on-chain wallet are used also for in-game activities. Examples are for breeding and evolving. You implemented a third step which drains the on-chain wallet within your platform called cash out. So only when the cash out is triggered, the funds are distributed. As long as they stay on the on-chain wallet, the funds are usable for game activities. And is it choosable for how much is being drained from the on-chain wallet?
Yeah, Jackie, that is entirely correct. So kind of a core component of the abstraction we've put together is that anything that is inside that wallet, which includes in-game assets, et cetera, anything that you would ordinarily be able to do with your MetaMask, a scholar will be able to do, except they cannot move assets out to a different wallet. So they can't steal any assets, but they can play with the assets easily. Anything that you have both in-game and in your wallet, so both on-chain and off-chain, they can play with that seamlessly. Then your question here on, is it choosable how much is being drained from the on-chain wallet? Yes. So inside the interface, what a scholar will do when they say, okay, you know, I've earned enough RBW today, I would like to go cash out some because I want to spend some. They'll go into the Cap app and they'll type in how much they want to cash out. It will move that amount from the on-chain wallet into the guild admin treasury, and then it will pay out the scholar however much split that you want to assign to the scholar, if that's 50% or whatever it happens to be. And Jackie, I do see your follow-up here. So can I limit how much they can cash out at once? So to date, we don't actually have a limit method. And we can certainly implement this if you're interested in it. Our thesis here is actually that it's not in a scholar's best interest to cash out everything all the time. A scholar, if they're assigned an account, we want to build incentive structures so that scholars essentially always choose the best thing for themselves, which aligns with the best thing for the guild, right? And so if a scholar makes the determination that they should spend all of their, you know, on-chain tokens in breeding new unicorns, et cetera, then at that point, you know, they would breed new unicorns in order to earn more cash and keep the loop running. But we certainly can implement limits if that's something that you're interested in. That's not particularly difficult to add.
Sam, I think Jackie has a follow-up question on here. They ask if there's some misalignment.
Yeah, let's see where Jackie goes with it. But we're generally excited to see and kind of noodle around these things.
All right, Jackie, you're still typing follow-up questions. All right, there. They give an example, upgrading buildings to level 6 currently net a decent ROI when wanting to move up into higher levels, the necessary investment which scholars would might not want to do because they prefer an early cash out.
Yeah, Jackie, and I definitely understand what you're getting at. So to clarify for the audience, what Jackie's basically saying is that it's in the guild's best interest to essentially reinvest certain assets in longer term ROIs versus just immediately cashing out the assets for early cash outs. So the discussion here is kind of around the quality of scholars that you have. And frankly, because of the way that it's set up, you can roll over scholars relatively easily if you, you know, see a scholar who's not performing in-game activities that's in line with what you want them to do. But the idea is that if you have a long-term scholar and that scholar is actually dedicated to the guild for the long term, they're actually going to want to upgrade those buildings to net the decent ROI, because the guild and the scholar both cash out in exactly the same way. So the scholar only gets cash when the guild gets cash, which is the scholar has to run the cash out function to move the tokens from in-game to out-of-game. So, you know, if it's higher ROI to wait a little bit longer and to cash out later, and the scholar's aware of that, then they will make that action, you know, to wait a little bit longer and to level up their buildings. We've actually already seen this in our early scholars. So inside the DAO here, you know, a number of the test scholars that we already run, the couple dozen that we have, they're actually spending 100% of their tokens upgrading buildings. And so they're basically like only reinvesting at this point. So it's really up to the scholars that you pick. And if they're, you know, just prioritizing a very short-term win, you can certainly roll them over.
All right, there's a cheer here on our text channel saying long-term rule, but another follow-up question from Jackie is, yeah, I get that, but the incentives are not aligned because they are driven by expectations and future developments within CU, and no limit method would heavily depend on the judgment of the scholar. But having the flexibility to roll over scholars makes sense and I appreciate it.
Yeah, and we would really just focus on that second point there, Jackie. You know, so long as managers can very easily roll over scholars, you know, if you see people who are performing short-term activities and it's, you know, it's not in your mutual best interest because for some reason they just have a very short-term thinking horizon and they don't want to wait a month, you can easily roll them over. It's not a problem.
Awesome. Thanks for that, everyone. That's it for tonight's short but sweet AMA event. Thank you so much for all of your questions and to Sam, of course, for accommodating all of them. Again, any questions directed towards Crypto Unicorns will be answered on tomorrow's Crypto Unicorns Town Hall 14. So don't you worry, you guys. So make sure to head on over to your discord.gg/CryptoUnicorns to get the latest information on the Crypto Unicorns Town Hall. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, you know what? We have really catered a lot of questions. Sam really catered a lot of questions, but I really can't blame them. As again, we are joined by an awesome founder right here. But before we go on our separate ways, any last words and announcements from Sam, maybe?
Yeah, sure, folks. So we actually just opened up self-onboarding for guilds. So you no longer need to fill out a waitlist form or anything like that. You can actually migrate over to app.capital.gg and you can immediately sign up, get the guild onboarding solution going, and you can be, you know, live with everything that we outlined here today within the next couple hours. And if you need any help on that, make sure that you drop a question into #apphelp, the channel up here under Capital DAO. I'll even link it here right now. If you have any issues, just drop a question in there. We'll have our engineers come over and they'll try to help you. But we're stoked to have you guys on board and we can't wait to see Crypto Unicorns keep topping the charts.
All right, thank you so much for that, Sam. Again, we cannot stress enough how honored we are to be joined by everybody's creative minds. And if you still want to learn more about Crypto Unicorns, we have a text channel that can be found on our Discord server for your reference, and also the town hall that was mentioned earlier by Claire. You may also follow Crypto Unicorns' social media accounts, which will be sent in the channel.
That's right. And a quick reminder for you guys that this is just the start of our September stretch as we have more AMAs coming up your way. So it's best to click on that bell icon on our events list to always be in the loop for more AMAs with more game developers.
That's right. And again, have a great day to everyone. That's a wrap for tonight. And we'll see you soon again here on Capital DAO's Discord. Thank you, everybody. Have a great day and have a great night. Thank you for joining us. Thank you,
Beth.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you, Sam. Thanks, everyone. Good morning. Good afternoon. Good night.
Also, a special mention to Jackie Ace, who really did a great job asking those questions. I hope they were able to, you know, help you as you invest your time and efforts with Crypto Unicorns. Way to go.